1, verses 1 through 11. These are the words of the teacher, King David's son, who ruled in Jerusalem. "Everything is meaningless," says the teacher, "completely meaningless. What do people get for all their hard work under the sun? Generations come and generations go, but the earth never changes. The sun rises and the sun sets, then hurries around to rise again. The wind blows south and then turns north. Around and around it goes, blowing in circles. Rivers run into the sea, but the sea is never full. Then the water returns again to the rivers and flows out again to the sea. Everything is wearisome beyond description. No matter how much we see, we are never satisfied. No matter how much we hear, we are not content. History merely repeats itself. It has all been done before. Nothing under the sun is truly new. Sometimes people say, 'Here is something new,' but actually it is old. Nothing is ever truly new. We don't remember what happened in the past, and in future generations, no one will remember what we are doing now."
Seems like yesterday. In a sermon given by Brian Wilkerson, titled the sermon was, "What's Your Story?" And he gave this illustration. Years ago, when our kids were young, we were out at a themed restaurant with TVs over all the walls, playing cartoons with no sound. Our youngest son, who was about 4 at the time, had his eyes glued to the TV screen. He was watching a continuous loop of Roadrunner cartoons, watching Wile E. Coyote strapped on a rocket-propelled roller skates, or shot himself out of a cannon, or launched himself from a giant slingshot in pursuit of the elusive Roadrunner. After watching intently for a long time, he had an epiphany. Without taking his eyes off the screen, he quietly announced to our family, "No matter what he does, he's never going to catch the chicken." And then he goes on to say, "Isn't that the human storyline? No matter what we do, we're never going to beat sin and death. No matter how many self-help books we read, no matter how many promises we make to ourselves and others, sin continues to wreak havoc on our careers, our relationships, and our good times. No matter how many peace treaties are signed, no matter how many relief efforts are launched, we still can't fix what's wrong with the world. And no matter how many vitamins we take, no matter how much we exercise and eat right, no matter how many advances we make in medicine, we just can't beat death. No matter what he does, he's never going to catch the chicken. Every human being since Adam and Eve has lived his or her own version of that same story. So, Brian Wilkerson's four-year-old boy at the time now understands life. Never going to catch the chicken. Solomon calls it completely meaningless and wearisome beyond description. And Bob Seger in our day, well, some of our day, they're all out. It's there. It wasn't. Bob Seger in our day calls it running against the wind. For most, an absolutely futile endeavor. You try and try and go and go and get knocked down and get up again and push back. But it never seems to end. But for some, the end has been success. How is that possible? Well, during this period of preparation for Easter, we're going to discuss that a little bit today. The title of today's message is Running Against the Wind Successfully. Our main scripture passage is going to be in Mark chapter 8, verses 27 through chapter 9, verse 1. And here Jesus begins the process of teaching his disciples then and now what being a disciple of the Messiah and Savior of the world is all about. How do you run against the wind successfully? How can you do it in such a way that it's not a futile effort, wearisome and futile? And to use it in toddler terms, how can you run in such a way that you do catch the chicken? Well, our passage is Mark chapter 8, and we'll be spending most of our time there today in the time that we have. Mark chapter 8, beginning in verse 27, and what we're going to do is we'll just go down and discuss as we go along. Okay, Mark chapter 28, chapter 8, boy, I wish I could speak English. Mark chapter 8, verse 27. Jesus and his disciples went on to the villages around Caesarea Philippi. Now, Caesarea Philippi, that was a big area, Caesarea city that Herod built for Caesar in his name, but named also after Philip of Macedonia, who was Philip the Great right before Alexander the Great, and because that's the Greek culture as well. That was the height of paganism in Israel at that time. And Jesus takes his disciples up right there to make this announcement. On the way, he asked them, though, first of all, who do people say I am? They replied, some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, still others, one of the prophets. In verse 29, we read, but what about you? He asked. Who do you say I am? And with regard to that question, that's valid today as well. Applies for you and me. Let's think about that question as we go through this message. Who do you say Jesus is? Peter answered. Peter was a special guy. I mean, we'll see as we go through this and beyond. Especially the Gospel of Mark. Mark was written by John Mark, who was apparently got the material from Peter when Peter was in Rome. And so Peter takes a very dim view of himself and his pals. You don't hear much of the good side of Peter in Mark. And so here Peter blurts out, or says, this time he didn't blurt out, he said, you are the Messiah. And Jesus warned them not to tell anyone about him. Now, he's been doing that a lot. And here, this is the, I'll read this and explain it better than I can. This is from the Biblical Imagination series by of the Gospel of Mark by Michael Card. First on Mark 8:27, the ominous, luminous words have finally been spoken. They fulfill part one of Mark chapter 1, verse 1. Jesus is the Christ or the Messiah. Now he strictly warns them to say nothing of it for now, because Jesus must teach them what Messiah truly means. You say the Messiah has come. Nobody's going to have a clue because they have something totally different in mind. Verse 31, he goes on to say, the fateful word Messiah has been spoken for the first time in Mark's gospel. Amidst a swirl of misunderstandings concerning the anointed one, Jesus sets out to undeceive the 12. Now, in some ways, he's still in the process of doing that with us today. At the time, Messiah represented a wide range of hopes and dreams in Israel. To some, he would be a glorious king who, with Jerusalem as his throne, would reestablish the theocratic nation of Israel. To many, he would be a militaristic Messiah who would come and kill the Roman oppressor. What these differing dreams all held in common was the notion of glory, victory, and divine power. Above all, the Messiah would never submit, surrender, or suffer. But in Mark 8:31, Jesus begins the painful process of redefining and undeceiving the disciples, which as you read through the rest of the Gospel of Mark until the time he dies and buried and is resurrected, all the way up to the end, and even when he ascends to heaven, before he ascends there, he's in the process of clarifying what Messiah really means, what the Messiah is all about. Verse 31. He then began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the teachers of the law, and that he must be killed and after 3 days rise again. He spoke plainly about this, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. Peter was a special guy. Read through the story. Peter's one of these fellows. You probably know a Peter, or maybe it's a Petra, depending upon whether it's male or female. There are some people, I'm not a diplomat, so I can't explain exactly the way I should explain what some people like Peter are like. I would say in the diplomatic form, they have a tendency to process things orally, okay? And the first thing that comes, they hear something that shocks them, it comes out what the first thought that comes in their mind. Peter was that type of person. We would say in the vernacular back when I was growing up, he put his mouth in motion before his brain was in gear, okay? And that had tended to be just the way he processed things. And so Jesus tells him this, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. Now, Peter didn't tell Mark what he said, but Matthew heard it as well. And in Matthew, it works it this way in Matthew 16:22. Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. Never, Lord, he said, this shall never happen to you. Why not? What was he saying? He was saying, Jesus, weren't you listening in a synagogue school? They explained, the rabbis have been teaching what Messiah would be like, what he would be doing, how he would come, how he would conquer. This can't happen. But when Jesus, verse 33, turned and looked at his disciples, he rebuked Peter. Get behind me, Satan, he said. You do not have in mind the concerns of God, but merely human concerns. Now, why did he look at his disciples? I can dogmatically answer that one. I don't know. But it would seem they must have been agreeing and saying the same thing. Yeah, we all heard that in school, you know. Well, what is this? The Messiah is going to be killed. And so Jesus comes out very strong. Get behind me, Satan. Get out of the way. You do not have in mind the concerns of God, but merely human concerns. In his commentary on Mark 8:31, N.T. Wright says this, so important is this message, the message of who Jesus is, who the Messiah is, what the Messiah will do, what God's way is all about, and how God is going about it, So important is this message that opposition to the plan, wherever it comes from, must be seen as satanic from the accuser. Even Peter, Jesus' right-hand man, is capable of thinking like a mere mortal. Now, does the fact that I'm standing up on a stage and you're down there mean that you're the mere mortals in this group? And no, we're all mere mortals. That even a mere mortal, thinking like a mere mortal, not looking at things from God's point of view. Peter was able, thought that way. We think that way as well. That's why the Holy Spirit inspired this whole passage for us to understand. And T. Wright goes on to say, this is a challenge to all of us, as the church in every generation struggles not only to think, but to live from God's point of view in a world where such a thing is madness. Nobody does it this way, which is so often so hard for us to do it, because no matter how we go about it, we're running against the wind. There's pushback of our own thinking, the whole way we look at things as well, because we're mere human beings. And T. Wright goes on to say, this is the point at which God's kingdom, coming on earth as it is in heaven, will challenge and overturn all normal human assumptions about power and glory, about what is really important in life and in the world. So Jesus had to come on strong. And the fact that he came on so strong and the Holy Spirit inspired means we have to think and take it very seriously as well. Am I thinking vertically? Am I seeing things from God's perspective? Am I thinking that way? Am I speaking that way? Am I doing things in such a way that he is represented and reflected? Or am I doing things the way it seems right and good to me? Without that perspective. Verse 34, then he called the crowd to him, along with the disciples, and said, so now here going forward, we got to understand he's getting ready. He's on his way to Jerusalem. This is going now. He is going to do what he just told his disciples. He's going to go there. He's going to get in big trouble with all the big authorities. They're going to despise him. They're going to persecute him. They're going to kill him. And somehow, when he said all that, for the disciples, it blew a fuse, and they never got this point where he said, after 3 days, he's going to rise again. Resurrection, what in the world was that? So he calls them along with his disciples and says, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves, as the New Living Translation words that, you must give up your own way and take up their cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it, and whoever loses their life for me and for the gospel will save it. What good is it for someone to gain the whole world yet forfeit their soul? Or what can anyone give in exchange for their soul? If anyone is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, the Son of Man will be ashamed of them when he comes in his Father's glory with the holy angels. So he's telling them, this is what's going to happen. We're going down there. If you're going to be ashamed of me, this is what you're going to experience. If you follow me, this is where we're going. If you want to come along, you're going to have to put aside the way you look at things and trust me. If you want to come along, you need to be ready. If you're following me all the way, the same thing that happened to me can happen and will happen to many. In some ways, some cases, most of you. And in certain ways, all of us will have to give up this life the way we would live it to be able to learn and live his life the way he lives it. And so the key to the whole thing, follow me. And then we go into verse 9, the last part of the actual context, chapter 9, verse 1. And he said to them, truly I tell you, some who are standing here will not taste death before they see the kingdom of God has come in with power. And then in verse 2 it tells what happens there. After 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and John with him and led them up a high mountain where they were all alone. There he was transfigured before them. We discussed that a few weeks ago. And if you missed it, Pastor Jeff brought the material. We should have the tape back there or the CD for you. So, what he told them was long before Bob Seger ever sang in a microphone. Nothing's going to change as far as how we have to live life. You're going to be running against the wind. But this is going to be different. And this is, you'll be successful if you follow me and stick with it. What is the wind? What's he talking about? I like the song. You know, it's crazy. I didn't even know all the words of that song. I'm just walking Cody, my dog, 6:30 in the morning. When was it? Thursday. Trying to figure out, now, how do I explain this whole thing? And, I have to be vulnerable. That's the term they use. So as I was rounding a corner and he was lifting his leg on a tree, all of a sudden that song came to my mind. I had to go home and I had to look it up on YouTube to figure out, see what it said. And I said, yeah, that's everybody, isn't it? That's what Jesus was saying. We're all being pushed back because we have a common enemy who wants to destroy us. What's the wind? First John chapter 2, verses 15 through 17 explains it the best. Interestingly enough, one of the three stooges, the three fellows that Jesus took with him up the mountain, who was one of the, you had Peter who always was blurting out what came to mind. He had his brain never got in gear in time before his mouth came open. And then you had the other two characters who were so hot-tempered that Jesus jokingly called them the sons of thunder. They were always out to, let's bring fire down, get rid of, let's solve the problem, And yet you read what they write later on after years of the Spirit of God transforming them and the Spirit of Jesus transforming. And John then writes, 1 John chapter 2, verses 15 through 17, New Living Translation, do not love this world, nor the things it offers you. For when you love the world, you do not have the love of the Father in you. For the world offers only a craving for physical pleasure, a craving for everything we see, and pride in our achievements and possessions. That's really what people are trying to get. And you go, and it doesn't work out. These are not from the Father, but are from the world. And this world is fading away along with everything that people crave. But anyone who does what pleases God will live forever. So, what do we do? How do we go about this? How do we run against the wind in a way that really will bring us forward? Get us closer and closer and closer to the chicken? Going back to what Jesus said to Peter, or at that time, but when Jesus turned and looked at his disciples, who were very likely expressing their agreement with Peter, he rebuked Peter and said, get behind me, Satan. You do not have in mind the concerns of God, but merely human concerns. So it begins with learning to think the way Jesus thinks. Learning to think the way Jesus thinks. I know I read this passage a lot, but this is the one that always rings true to me over the Apostle Paul's writing in 2 Corinthians 5:16, where he says, so from now on, because he was the same way. He was the same type of a hothead. He was a little bit different. There was only one way, and that was this way, and everything else was of the devil. Until Jesus tripped him up, and he came to know the living Christ. 2 Corinthians 5:16 says, from now on, we regard no one from a worldly point of view. Though we once regarded Christ in this way, we do so no longer. You know, I find that very difficult. But the more I think along these lines, the more it's helping me to see people that really rub me the wrong way differently. They didn't love Jesus, rub Jesus the wrong way. He died for them. If I remember that, it changes everything. And I can begin to understand somebody that I never really wanted to understand. It's an amazing thing. And then Jesus says in Mark, verse 34, Mark 8, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves, take up their cross, and follow me. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it. Whoever loses their life for me and for the gospel will save it. Warren Wiersbe, in an article in Christianity Today, entitled A Time to Be Renewed, said this: to deny self does not mean to deny things. Not in the same way if you're training in sports for a medal or something like that, or you just have a certain goal and you've got to do something, you've got to change, you've got to sacrifice, you've got to do without. That's not what it's talking about here. To deny self does not mean to deny things. It means to give yourself wholly to Christ and share in his shame and death. To take up a cross does not mean to carry burdens or have problems. I once met a lady who told me her asthma was the cross she had to bear. To take up the cross means to identify with Christ in his rejection, shame, suffering, and death. And as we move toward Easter, we are moving with his disciples as he's starting them on the road. And that is our goal, to be like him. Doesn't sound too appetizing if you were thinking just horizontally, does it? William J. O'Malley, in an article that was quoted in Christianity Today, made this comment. Listen to this carefully. Quite unlike Hitler or the Stones or Hefner. That's quite a combination. You talk about the Three Stooges. I mean, that's quite a combination. Quite unlike Hitler or the Stones or Hefner, who also changed the world. That's what they haven't had in common. Who also changed the world simply by intuiting which way the parade was heading and getting in front of it. Jesus did not give us a message we wanted to hear. He came to turn the parade in precisely the opposite direction. He spoke words hard for our canny hearts even to give credence to, much less heed. Take the last place. The real parade is heading in the other direction. Forget yourself, even your shortcomings. Take up your cross, heal the hateful, love your enemies as yourself. I'd like to read one last example as a little bit of food for thought, and then we'll, one more time, we'll look at our passage we started out with. This comes from a sermon given by Haddon Robinson called Love Keeps Going. Several years ago, I helped lead a tour in Turkey of the churches mentioned in the book of Revelation. On the last night, we were in the city of Izmir and were having dinner at one of its nicer hotels. Our guide had been in the United States at least 10 years and spoke English flawlessly. As we were eating, he began to ask us questions, serious questions, about the Christian faith. I said to him, if you're a follower of Islam, and if you died tonight, would you be sure you could stand in the presence of Allah? No, he replied. There are five things that Muslims should do. I've done two out of five. He had a ways to go. Then we began to talk about the gospel. We talked about it long into the night. And before we left, I said to him, "Look, you're serious about our conversation, I know. It would not be faithful of me to ask you if right now you'd like to put your trust and confidence in Jesus Christ." He said to me, "You don't know what you're asking me. Do you know what would happen if I did that? If I announced it to anybody, my wife would leave me, my family would disown me, my boss would fire me. I may want to leave and go back to the United States, and the government would not give me an extra visa, an exit visa. I'd give up everything. You can go back home tomorrow. I would not expect you would support me, and I would starve to death in my own culture." No. Haddon Robinson went on to say, "As far as I know, he did not trust Christ that night. But there are people who have made that decision and suffered all that loss and endured those hardships because they are Christ followers. If you think," he writes, "that Romans 8:28, all things work together for good to them who love God, to them who are the called according to his purposes, is a promise that you'll have a middle-class life in a lovely little church in a nice little town where you may even get a pass to the country club, you're wrong. Paul did not promise that." As we move toward Easter and the celebration and commemoration of all that Jesus has done to change everything, turn the train around, or the parade, or whatever we want to call it, and head us all in the right direction if we choose to follow him. One more time, let's read. I'll read for us the key parts of the passage. Then I'm going to ask Melinda to come up and lead us in the last song, which is at the same time is going to be our closing prayer, and also our song of dedication for this period of time. Mark 8:34 through 38. "Then he called the crowd to him, along with his disciples, and said, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it. And whoever loses their life for me and for the gospel will save it. What good is it for someone to gain the whole world yet forfeit their soul? Or what can anyone give in exchange for their soul? If anyone is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, the Son of Man will be ashamed of them when he comes in his Father's glory with his all angels." So now I'd like to ask you all to rise as we pray together in song the conclusion of this service.